Welcome again to this most excellent day. And why is it excellent? Because the opportunity is here today to clarify your basic premises. Why do this? Well, because if you've had an experience of truth for a moment, then your job is to go back to your basic premises that you believe in and to make sure that they align with this experience that you've had of reality of truth. And if they do not align, then you need to examine them very carefully and say, how come they're not aligning? What's the problem here? And that opportunity is present every single day. That's why each day is a most excellent day. So today, let's go over one of the most key premises of all, and that is authorship of the universe. What is the author of the universe? Who authored this universe is the question. Everybody has some opinion about that. Even those who say we have no idea, it's a mystery, we don't know. That's an opinion, isn't it? Those who say God, the prime creator, authored this universe, have an opinion. Those who say God the Son, Spirit, authored this universe, they have an opinion. There are those who say that it authored itself. There is no author, that's an opinion. So look at these variables and you say, what aligns with truth? If you've had an experience of reality, then you say, what aligns with that? What fits perfectly like a glove? Okay, the answer is that Spirit, God the Son, Spirit, the same as the same thing, is the author of this universe. God the Prime Creator is not the author of this universe. It's Spirit authored this universe. Okay? If you take this to be true, then you can use that as part of your foundation of premises, and you will see how that begins to help everything else align. But if this cornerstone is misaligned, if you say, for instance, God the Father, the Prime Creator, is the author of this universe, then nothing else is really going to fit well. Everything will seem be it's not quite aligned. We've worked so hard to try and align everything with this premise, and it doesn't work. Whereas if you say God the Son is the author, you will find an incredible alignment, and all of your puzzlements and frustrations of how to get this to align will gradually dissolve. And you realize, this answers everything. That now I can see, now I can undo and untangle all these deceptions, because I have the basic premise is correct. God the Son is the author of this universe. It's God the Son that chose the idea that authored this universe. When Spirit chooses ideas, that idea automatically is presented by mind as an experience. So God the Son chose the idea of trying to replace reality with a new reality. That automatically, mind automatically then presented that as an experience to God the Son. And this presentation of that experience is what we call the universe. And the reason why it is so difficult to see this, there is a reason. Spirit is denying that it is the author of this universe. That is the crucial way that Spirit maintains the universe. That literally, the maintenance of this universe is based on Spirit denying that it is the author of this universe. That's the only way. Because when Spirit sees that it is the author of the universe, all other deceptions have to fall away. And then Spirit will decide easily that it wants to choose another idea. This idea is not giving it the experience that it wanted at all. In fact, it's giving an experience of misery. So it will choose a new idea. So this is the all-important premise. As long as Spirit denies authorship of the universe, Spirit can jump through all these hoops trying to work with whatever is the author of this universe, thinking that, well, it's out of my hands, Spirit will say. I'm not in control of it, but ask for help from the true author. Maybe the true author will have compassion on me, have mercy on me, give me miracles, and make this universe my home, make me feel competent here, comfortable, stable, competent, make me feel completely supported in this universe. But if Spirit realizes that it's the author of this universe, then Spirit realizes it's all in Spirit's hands. Spirit is entirely responsible for all of it. There isn't any other power or capability that can change it or do anything with it. Then Spirit will realize, the game is up. It is what it is. I can't change it. There's no power that can change it. You see how that works? So Spirit's giving itself false hope in saying that there's some other author. That's false hope. Spirit can pray to this other imaginary author of existence forever, thinking that it somehow can get response to its prayers to intercede in existence and make existence the way that Spirit wants it to be. But these prayers will never be answered because there isn't any third party involved in existence, in the authorship of existence. It's all Spirit, 100%. God, the Prime Creator, did not choose this idea, did not tell Spirit to choose this idea. That's another deception that Spirit tells itself, that God the Father mandated that Spirit choose this idea. Not true. You see, if that were, that's a false hope, because if it were true, then Spirit could say, well, I can just pray to God the Prime Creator to intercede in this idea and make this idea the way that I want it to be, so I feel comfortable with this idea, feel competent. Not true. God the Father does not intercede in ideas like that. God the Father only reminds Spirit that Spirit's free to choose another idea. And that is the answer to why do bad things keep happening in existence? How come God the Father has not fixed everything to make us happy here? That's not how reality functions. If you don't like the experiencing of an idea, choose another one. That's how reality functions. It's like a little child is frustrated and unhappy and they're crying, and want mommy and daddy to take away its discomfort. Spirit is like that, crying and whining to God the Father, saying, I want you to take away my discomfort with this idea. And God the Father says, can't do it. Can't do it, because if God the Father did that, it would invalidate all other ideas, wouldn't it? It would mean that the ideas do not have their effects, and Spirit could not trust a single other idea. So God the Father does not intercede in existence. Divine grace doesn't intercede in that way. Divine grace is a reminder to choose another idea. That's what it does. It's a reminder to clarify your premises. It's a reminder to Spirit to own up to responsibility for authorship of this universe. It's a reminder to remember how reality functions. That's how God's grace works in existence. But God's grace does not prevent, stop, intercede with the dynamics of existence, the constructivity and then the ensuing destructivity. Does not stop that. And neither constructivity nor destructivity ever wins. There's no winner. There's just a continual dance of it. That's how existence plays out. That's how it will always play out. Existence will never be other than what it has already always been. That's what it is. And sure, your intention can go up the corporate ladder of existence, but you will find out that later on your attention will go down the corporate ladder of existence. As you go up the corporate ladder, you think that you're making progress towards contentment and feeling of competency. But ultimately, as you reach the top of the corporate ladder, you will find yourself then going down the other side, feeling that by going down, you're actually making progress in competency. So you just continually cycle, go in these cycles, little cycles, medium cycles, big cycles, on and on and on this way. And spirit may cry out to God saying, stop all this, stop it. I want all this to stop. I can't stand it anymore. But that'll never happen. Because it's not up to God to mandate what idea spirit chooses. God cannot stop spirit from experiencing an idea. But however, spirit can choose a new idea. It's spirit that's in control of what idea it experiences. So it's spirit that has to decide, I want a new idea. I'm going to choose a new idea. And God is not withholding ideas from spirit. All ideas are perfectly available every single instant. There's no restrictions. Spirit doesn't need to learn anything to choose a new idea. Doesn't need to evolve at all. That's just another way of spirit delaying the idea of evolving consciousness. It's just a delaying tactic. All ideas are available this instant to spirit. Spirit can choose one right this instant and move on from the idea of existence and its discontentment and feeling of non-supportiveness and feeling of incompetency. All that will vanish as spirit chooses a new idea. And then God will say, great, now you're back in the flow of functioning as you were created to function. Wonderful. That's how it goes. And in the meantime, spirit continues to frantically search for false hope. Spirit says, other than choosing a new idea, what do you advise me to do? That's really what spirit asks. Which is a trick question, isn't it? Because it's saying, other than the actual remedy, what kind of remedy do you have? There isn't any other remedy. That's the answer. And then spirit will say, God, you're not as powerful as I thought you were, because you can't even come up with another remedy other than the actual one. I thought you were all powerful, all creative, and you could do that. But God is not tricked or fooled by that in any way. Spirit is trying to trick God that way, trying to prove that it is more powerful than God, saying, God, give me another remedy other than choosing a new idea. I want a different remedy. God says, cannot do that. There is none, because you were created. I created you perfect to function perfectly, and that is the way that you have to function. You're free. I cannot restrict your freedom. All ideas are free for you every instant, and the effects of every idea are perfectly in alignment with the ideas. If I intercede with the effects of one idea, that means I've interceded with the effects of all ideas. And you'll never be able to trust me or function ever again. So God is not fooled by our very clever cries for mercy here to intercede. Fortunately for us, that is true. So we lose patience with God. We're saying, God doesn't answer our prayers. You know, forget it. I'm going to stop believing and there's any prime creator. Because we're asking for something that God cannot give us, cannot alter reality. That's what we're trying to do. But God is certainly not going to help us in that. And we think, if we just suffer terribly enough, God will finally relent and say, okay, I'll intercede. So we keep suffering and suffering and suffering and say, well, maybe if I suffer even worse, even more terribly, then God will intercede and say, okay, I can't take it anymore. I'm going to intercede with the effects of this idea and change those effects. You can keep the idea, but I'm going to change the effects. No, that will never, ever happen. And that's good news for you, because that means suffering as a strategy is useless. You see that, you turn away from suffering, so it doesn't work. And then you begin to get serious, say, okay, let's choose a new idea. We're like a kid trying to see if you can manipulate the parents. See, what can I do? Can I get them to do what I want them to do? And so we try all sorts of things. And in our case, none of them works. And we believe that at some point, God will finally relent and say, oh, I can't stand it anymore. I see my son going down this trail of tears for so long. I'm finally going to intercede. That's what we're hoping as we're on this dusty trail of tears. We said, I can't believe God hasn't interceded. I can't believe it. Certainly, any moment God will intercede. You know, but it never happens. never happens. You look at history and you see it hasn't happened. You look at your ancestors and you see the trail of tears they were on. Didn't happen for them. Didn't happen to their ancestors and theirs and theirs. And you go back in history of existence, you realize it's never happened. And you realize the incredible suffering and misery and trail of tears that so many have been through and it never happened. Then why do you believe it's going to happen for you? It won't. And it won't happen for your heirs and your succeeding heirs, etc., etc., etc. Never. Will never happen. So the best benefit you can pass on to anyone is to remind them of this fact. And people try to avoid this realization by saying, well, it happens for them in heaven. After they die, that's when it happens. But this notion of, is reality segmented into this kind of division, where there's a part where you're unaware of happiness, and then there's a part where you're aware of happiness. Is that really reality, or is that just a clever ploy we're using to try and deny the fact that God does not intercede by projecting it into the future and saying, well, once we die, then we get the fruits of God's intercession? We know obviously reality is not that way. Reality is a seamless unity and whole. If there was any benefit for us, it would be a completely apparent in all situations, conditions. So the fact that we're here in this world and we're not experiencing the intercession means there is no intercession. And don't put any belief that somehow you'll find this intercession once you die. That is not true. What happens when you die is you find out the intercession isn't there, and then you think that you need to go back and be reborn and to find it there. You got to keep looking for it. You say, well, it's not here, so I need to keep looking for it somewhere else. You get reborn, you look for it here, and it's not here, and you think, well, maybe I'll find it when I die. You die and you look for it, you don't find it, you come back here over and over and over and over. The answer is you never find it. There is no intercession. God cannot change the effects of an idea for you. But you can choose a new idea. And so how do you get off that endless carousel of birth and death, birth and death, birth and death, birth and death, like that over and over, choosing a new idea that gets you off that carousel, that merry-go-round? A funny thing, it's your very belief that God has interceded in this world which gives you the distrust in choosing a new idea. It's that very thing. The more you believe that God intercedes in this world, the less you'll be willing to choose a new idea, because then you won't trust a new idea. You won't trust the effects that idea will be in alignment with the idea. So it'll fixate you even worse here. So the real good news is not that God intercedes here, is that God does not intercede here. And when you hear that, then you have faith in choosing a new idea. You'll say, thank you, God, because now I realize the new idea, the effects will be perfectly in alignment with that. And I can trust in it. Miracles here are not intercessions by God. They're time-saving devices that bring you more quickly to the realization that God does not intercede here. They're situations that enable you to see clearly. And you see clearly, then it makes all the rest of the time you had been stumbling around in blindness unnecessary for you. So the Holy Spirit does work in this world to orchestrate situations such that you can more easily see. And that saves you time. You can more easily see the futility of what you've been trying to do. Seeing futility is not a despairing vision at all. It's a wonderful vision, because you realize you're futile. Your efforts are futile to destroy yourself. Your efforts to change reality are futile. Your efforts to trick God into interceding are futile, which means all other ideas are perfectly available to you. The entire richness of reality is perfectly intact for you because your efforts to destroy it have been futile. So it's a wonderful clarity. It brings true hope to you, not despair, but true hope. So the Holy Spirit is not changing the effects of this idea. It's helping you see what those effects are. It's helping you see the deceptions that you've been utilizing. It's helping you see clearly what it's all about, what you've been trying to do. And when you see it clearly, you say, I don't want to keep doing this. It's ridiculous. Complete waste of time, aimlessly wandering around with no purpose or meaning whatsoever. I want to choose a new idea and get back to functioning the way I was created to function. It's that simple. So don't fear disillusionment. Embrace disillusionment. It's the most wonderful thing when you experience it. You say, oh, finally I'm no longer trapped in that dynamic. That's great. Now one more issue to look at here. Some do get saved from destructivity, but that's not God interceding in existence. Because the very nature of existence is constructivity and destructivity, continual dance of that. In order for this dance to continue, one side can never vanquish the other. Constructivity can never vanquish destructivity. Destructivity can never vanquish constructivity. So in any destructive situation, there will always be offshoots of constructivity taking place somewhere, somehow. And as far as those who are working to clarify the situation, they may seem to sidestep destructivity because in been doing so, they are better able to help out the Holy Spirit in its job to save time by helping others see clearly what's going on. And that's the role. It's not a helpful thing to engage in destructivity, nor is it helpful to engage in too much constructivity. It's usually better to be in a situation where the two are kind of in a playing kind of idling. The engine is idling. But when it gets engines revved up, very intense, that's not the very best situation to help save time, help everyone, help spirits see clearly. So sidestepping destructivity is not an intervention by God the Father at all. It's merely part of the play of divine grace here that is working towards helping save everyone time. Dynamics of existence remain the same, but the efforts of those who are working to save time, those efforts need to continue on unobstructed. And the question, does God want you to wake up? The answer is yes. God wants you to function as you were created to be functioning. And right now, we are fixated on this idea and not really flowing and choosing the way that we were created. So God does want us to wake up, meaning to realize that we can choose a new idea. God does not say what idea we have to choose, simply that we're aware we can choose a new idea. And that's our natural functionality. That is the point that God the Father is working to get us to. That awareness that we can choose a new idea, that's our natural functionality we were created with, and that we can't change this. And then from that point, then spirit has to exercise its will in choosing. Now, spirit can choose to remain with this idea if it wants to, but God wants spirit to be aware of what it's doing. Right now, spirit is in this like deep, deep sleep of forgetfulness. And that is not the will of God for spirit to go into a deep, deep sleep of forgetfulness. So although God does not intercede with the effects of an idea, God does bring spirit awake to its functionality and the fact that it is choosing this idea. Okay, so that is an important clarification. Not intervention, but divine grace towards awakening, towards remembering. That's what's really going on right now and what is always going on in existence. And always will be, until all aspects of spirit have finally awoken to true functionality and realization that spirit is the author of this idea, and the spirit wants to change the effects, spirit has to choose a new idea. That's it. That's the only way that works. And eventually all aspects of spirit will wake up to that. The goal is to speed that whole process up of awakening. And that's what we're engaged in right here, by the speaking and by your listening. That's exactly what's taking place. Okay, wonderful. That's it.